not Indians.
Obviously, where they come from, and as Bob showed us over the photographs and so on. They use smoke, but they would start a fire and on the rope, so on, crawl up there, and they would swing that in front of the hive. But they still do that in Africa. A very good honey bee, nectar sort of forages, but aggressive nectar scares. Bob was in Nicaragua, he'll say it several times, in Judy was in Nicaragua 2 years ago. You're in Nicaragua. Anyhow, he worked with the Africanized bees. And there was nectar available, so they just use a lot more smoke. That's the difference. But if they don't have the nectar available, they're mean. I have stood by, I don't do this with a beehive. I don't stand, I don't know, or shorts here. But I've done Tucson, Arizona, at the Research Center, and I stood beside an Africanized beehive. Bees fly in and out, bee volume goes up. Now I can take my honeybees, take the top off, and pretty soon they start dipping my fingers. And so they're calm until there's not enough food, or if you bang things around. Now, the only honeybees will do that is this too. You don't get a hive, you do everything very slow and gentle. Okay, buck fast. Bob was mentioning with history. Very often, people in religion work with honeybees, and this is true of the buckfast bees. Buckfast was developed in England. It was made in several races. They're highly tracheolite resistant. Tracheolite is a microscopic organism. Insects have a breathing apparatus, they don't have a lung. They breathe through the sides of their thorax and their abdomen. So they have spiracles and then they have the trachea. One of the naughty things that professors do at universities, grad students, do is study. And very often has to be a student. If you held a grasshopper, and they think you can throw it behind you, if you held a grasshopper, but it's in the water, how long would it take for it drop? Well, the answer is, whenever you get tired, the grasshopper will still be alive because you didn't drop because you didn't cover the spirals. They don't have lungs, they don't breathe through the nose, they breathe through the sack. They're slow to build up in the spring. Over winters, they certainly will. Low amount of June and fall. I've had buck fast. Buy buckfast. Weavers in Texas, one of the weavers doesn't have buckfast, the other one does. But if you want buckfast, you can order them through the weaver catalog, which one of carnelians, you might get carnelians. Carnelians overwinter well, likely to swarm on those lands well. Any of these will swarm. I'm reading your book of Bob's. Not quite finished, Bob. Anyhow, he wants a book back. But it's a natural beekeeper. And the fellow there says, swarming is a good thing. Because swarming shows that the hive is healthy. It's that. If you don't have a way to capture the swarm, then you lost the swarm. Okay? And this way of perpetuating the species. So, I'll say this to you, have these, have an extra box. I have a, what is called a nuke here. It's a half of a box. Set one of those out with the frame of the foundation. The rest of them, you put the frames in there, don't put anything else in. And the bees will find them. And then you take that and build up your little hives. So if you have an extra swarm box or something, the swarm box is just a box of the frame that you're in. Okay? Carnelians. Carpathians. Anybody for patients who have a little while, longer tongue. You're talking about alpha. And the seed that the government grows helps subsidize. When you plant the alfalfa, the honeybee usually doesn't have a long enough tongue to reach down into the first cutting blossom of alfalfa. But the second cutting and the third cutting, they do have the losses when they're shallow. Caucasians are equivalent to Cordovans. I saw someplace a new cell for Cordovans. Suburban cultivars, winter food consumption, they use a lot of food. They have to have plenty of food for it. Italians, many people get Italians, or a general type of being. Rather builds home, prone to winter starvation. In other words, they use a lot of food. Called to work with, built up a lot of fruit. But a lot of these are Italians, such as you get. Some of them you can tell the difference. Russian. Russian are really European bees, but 150 years ago or so, somebody took bees from Europe and took them into Siberia and into that area. And so the bees were isolated, I guess, from the other bees. But they came in contact with the tracheal mites. I'm sorry, the burrow mites, the outside, the mites on the outside. And so they got resistant to the mites. The mites might be gone, but the tolerant to the mites. And so they shipped them over to this country. So we have the Russians, resistant to varroa, susceptible to colony. They're supposed to be wild, not colony. Colony plasmid. Resistant to tracheal mites and susceptible to nosema. That's one of the diseases you get fine for in the wintertime. The one that I didn't put in here, and that is the variety of bee developed by Marla Spivak at the University of Minnesota. And they are hygienic bees. I think the last time I talked about some of those sources of bees, and I mentioned Jim Whitlock. And Jim Whitlock has some of Marla Spivak's bees. So if you order the news from Jim Whitlock, go get some of the identities from the University of Minnesota. Because only certain